Hi, this is Dr. A with your next video in pregnancy and prenatal testing as a clinical chemistry review. And we're going to look at the different analytes that are used for maternal and fetal health assessment. So first we're going to start with the laboratory confirmation of pregnancy. So that is done through the detection of beta human chorionic gonadotropin, also known as beta HCG. Beta HCG doubles every 24 hours until the 8th week, and it peaks at the 10th week, and then it will decrease until 16 weeks, and then it maintains. It peaks at around 100,000 international units per milliliter at the end of the first trimester. HCG is made by the trophoblast and then by the placenta, and it stimulates the corpus luteum to keep making progesterone, and progesterone is necessary to maintain the pregnancy and to suppress menstruation. And so THC and HCG are very similar. It can cross-react so that HCG can stimulate the thyroid to release thyroid hormone. The sample that we use to test for beta HCG is either serum or urine, and this is a hormone that is detected in your average pregnancy test that you can buy at the pharmacy or grocery store. So the HCG levels can be qualitative or quantitative. So qualitative is positive, negative, and they're your point of care testing. So again, those tests that you can buy at the pharmacies. And the only thing is you could get a false negative. So that's a negative when it should be positive due to a very dilute urine or if you test too early. So just as a note, if you go and look at the pregnancy video before this, we talk about kind of the timing of everything. So HCG is not really produced until the fertilized egg has implanted into the uterus. And so between the fertilization and the implantation, there's about a week. And so if somebody had sex and there was ovulation around the time and fertilization occurred, if you test the next morning, it's probably going to be negative. You need to wait at the bare minimum a week, probably two, after ovulation to test to be able to detect pregnancy. So a quantitative gives you an actual number, an actual concentration. And most physicians want to know the actual HCG concentration to ensure that it is rising appropriately and to aid in the determination of how many weeks along the pregnancy is. So serial HCG, so those are HCGs that are done like several days apart in a row. They can also help detect abnormal pregnancies, for example, a non-viable pregnancy if it fails to rise. So it should be doubling up, 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 up. So if it's not increasing, then it could maybe show that the pregnancy is not taken. And Down syndrome if it's too high also. The quantitative assays are usually performed on an immunoassay analyzer. So alpha-fetoproteins, so they are often tested in the mother's serum, and they are known as maternal serum alpha-fetoprotein, or MSF-AFP. The AFP is produced by the yolk sac and then by the fetus's liver. And these AFP levels will rise at the end of the first trimester and then drop around 32 weeks and then slowly fall to adult levels after birth. So AFP screening is recommended between 15 and 20 weeks, and the levels should be between 10 to 150 nanograms per milliliter. And the methodology used is usually a form of immunoassay. It does ask if testing and retesting needs to be done, or if a clinic is using a specific immunoassay to just stick with it and to not be switching methodologies or testing sites. So alpha-fetoprotein results are often interpreted as the multiples of the median, also known as MOM. And this compares the patient's AFP levels to the median of the reference range to overcome variables that can influence the results. So there's things like age and ethnic background, and et cetera. There's all kinds of things that can affect these levels. So To get the multiples of the median, you divide the mother's AFP levels by the median of the reference range. So that's the middle value of the reference range. And the range for the mean of the median for the maternal serum AFP is 0.5 to 2.0. So elevated AFP levels may indicate neural tube defects. So those are things like spinal bifida and encephaly. Could potentially indicate a low birth weight or an intrauterine growth restriction or premature delivery and possibly intrauterine fetal death. It can also be an indicator of preeclampsia in the mom. Decreased levels of alpha-fetoprotein levels can be an indicator that the fetus has Down syndrome, which is trisomy 21, or possibly trisomy 18, which is Edwards syndrome. We can also do fetal amniotic fluid alpha-fetoprotein. So if the mom's alpha-fetoprotein is higher than normal, then there's no explanation for it. So things that could cause an higher than normal AFP that would have an explanation would be like multiple fetuses, so twin or triplet pregnancies, or they have incorrectly calculated the gestation of the fetus. But if all of those things are ruled out, then we can do amniotic fluid testing. And for it, the multiple of the median for an open spina bifida is 7, and the one for an encephaly is 20. You do have to be careful with the sample, contamination of the sample with blood, whether it's from mom or from the baby, can interfere with the testing. The next one is unconjugated estriol. So E3 or estriol is the predominant estrogen in pregnancy. It is made in the placenta. It is present in maternal serum in low levels, and it is an indicator of fetal health. So levels can increase with the gestational age and they reach maximum level at the end of the pregnancy. Decreased levels in the second trimester have been associated with adverse pregnancy outcomes such as preeclampsia, intrauterine growth retardation, and low birth weight. Low unconjugated estriol levels are seen in Down syndrome and in trisomy 18, and you do want to separate the serum and test promptly within 7 days at least, and these are usually immunoassays also. Inhibin A, its primary job is to suppress FSH. So FSH's job is to mature eggs and stuff. So we're in pregnancy, so we don't need that. So inhibin A, will suppress the follicle stimulating hormone. It is measured in maternal serum to screen for Down syndrome, and increased maternal levels of inhibin A in the second trimester can indicate possible Down syndrome. It could possibly predict the development of preeclampsia, and it is stable in maternal serum and is also measured by immunoassay. So the triple and quadruple screen tests, it is used to screen, this is very important, this is a screening test, and to report risk estimates for anencephaly, spinal bifida, and birth defects such as Down syndromes and Edwards syndrome, etc. So it is routinely done between the 16 and 20th weeks of gestation. And the triple screen is AFP, HCG, and unconjugated estriol. And the quad screen is AFP, HCG, unconjugated estriol, and inhibin A. And then a positive screen should always, always, always be followed up with a diagnostic test. So this is a screening test. We're going to do diagnostic tests to know exactly what's going on. A few miscellaneous tests. So we have acetylcholinesterase. It's important in the detection of neural tube defects like anencephaly and spina bifida. And if it's present in amniotic fluid, then that could indicate neural tube defects or present in increased amount anyway. So pregnancy-associated plasma protein A is most valuable for screening purposes during the first trimester of pregnancy. And low PAPPA concentrations in the first trimester are seen in trisomy 13, which is Fetal syndrome, trisomy 18, which is Edwards syndrome, trisomy 21, which is Down syndrome, and Turner syndrome. We also have a few more. We have progesterone. So this placental hormone plays an important role in the establishment and maintenance of healthy pregnancy. So this is especially important early on. And so sometimes it can test for that. Also, progesterone can be given to help maintain a healthy pregnancy at the beginning. And this would be done in moms that may have a risk of spontaneous abortions. And the oral glucose tolerance test is usually done during the 24th to 28th week of pregnancy in all patients in order to screen them for gestational diabetes. So the mom usually comes in fasting. The screening test now is just a 1-hour oral glucose tolerance test. They give about 50 grams. So they come in fasting, get 50 grams of glucose that they drink, and then 1 hour later we do a glucose test. And if it is less than 140 milligrams per deciliter, then mom is fine. If it is above 140, then we need to repeat the test with a longer oral glucose tolerance test, like a 2 or 3 hour one. And then lastly, fetal fibronectin. This test is useful for assessing the risk that preterm delivery will occur in the next 7 to 14 days in women that have signs and symptoms of preterm labor. So we can use that to see if baby is coming or if we still have some time. So, all right, so that wraps up all of our testing for maternal and fetal health.